Welcome back to your favorite Minecraft YouTuber. I survived 100 days in hardcore Minecraft, even though I should be working on more important projects. Well, it's that time of the year again. I'm addicted to Minecraft. Quick message to my regular viewers, don't leave. This is a technical video and I wanted to have some creative fun, and I will explain in just a moment what the heck this is about, but feel free to skip ahead to the fun part with the chapter markers below in the description. Anyway, before we get going in this new Minecraft world, let's go back 1 minute to the time before the Big Bang and actually create this world. I'm using here a specific seed which I intentionally do not share because this is a small challenge for you. Try to find the seed of this world, and if you find it, please don't share it publicly just yet and write to me on Twitter or email and tell me how you did it. Anyway, this is of course hardcore Minecraft survival, so let's trigger the Big Bang and create this world. Well, all of this is just fake and acting anyway. I'm not playing in single player, so let's go back and connect to my server. Now we can get started in this new world. Probably the first thing everybody does in a new Minecraft world is punish some trees to gather wood. So of course, I do the same. With the gathered wood, we can craft our first tool, a pickaxe. It wouldn't be Minecraft without a pickaxe. I also climbed on some trees and looked into the distance to see if we can find anything interesting. And I saw a village just at the horizon. And there was another village, much closer, just up the hill from our spawn. What a coincidence, we really got lucky with this totally random world. And so I went straight into the city and pillaged it. This is my world, I created it, I take what belongs to me. Sorry, the power sometimes gets to my head. Anyway, I wanted to tell you what this project is about. So while I explore this world, oh, a shipwreck. Steal, gather material and looking for where to set up my first base, let me tell you about the one single important lesson I want to take away from this video. But let's go to bed first and rest well because we have a long day ahead. Aww. Good morning. I slept really good in my bed in my house. Actually, I want to explore the shipwreck that we saw yesterday, so let's do that while I tell you about the one single lesson that I want you to take away from this video. That's the only thing I want you to remember. Having fun when exploring hacking or computer science in general is the most important aspect. In my opinion, it doesn't matter what you do to learn as long as you learn. I know nowadays there are tons and tons of courses out there, lots of free material, lots of paid trainings, and I'm sure theoretically out there somewhere is the perfect training for you. The most efficient, most straight to the point lecture. But it will probably be boring as hell. Just a dump of information won't engage you for long. And when you want to get into hacking, being into this for the long run is important. While some people, maybe including me, give you the impression you can learn the stuff in a few weeks, that's impossible. I've been doing this stuff for about 10 years now, and maybe this comes across as arrogant, but I just think it's the obvious truth. You won't learn what I know in a month or even 2 years. I know how many thousands of hours I have spent working on projects and learning, and so I know it takes time. But don't be discouraged, because I just told you how you can get to that point as well. Just stay motivated, curious, engaged, and accumulate the many hours it takes, and you will get there as well. And that's why I think it's so important to find projects that are fun to you. For me, 10 years ago, it was discovering war games and CTFs like Over the Wire or Pico CTF. That's what kept me engaged for a long time, and that's where I learned the most. I try to share my excitement for CTFs and show you that it can be fun, but it doesn't have to be fun for you. You just have to find something else. This is also the only advice I can give when somebody asks me what they should study at university. I always say, don't worry, just take the subject that is fun to you. If it's fun, it will be easier to motivate yourself, it's less stressful, and with the additional energy, you maybe on the side can spend some time on additional projects to learn. And now we come back to Minecraft. Minecraft is a game, a fun game, at least fun to millions of people, of course kids, but also adults. And recently with the new 1.18 Caves and Cliffs update, I installed the game again and got addicted. I wasted my time playing Minecraft instead of learning more hacking. Does the last sentence ring a bell? Around 4 years ago, I made a video titled, "Stop wasting your time and learn more hacking." In that video, I explained that it's totally okay to take a break and play games. It's fine. Hacking takes a lot of hours to learn, so of course you will have periods with no motivation or where other stuff just takes priority. And getting addicted to a game is the struggle I often have. And the solution I proposed in this video was to somehow turn the game addiction into a fun project. In that video, I reverse engineered and hacked a mobile game. And now this Minecraft video makes sense, right? I turned my Minecraft addiction into a technical project. The Minecraft community is incredible. The technical projects that exist in this space is fascinating. I hope in this video series I can show you how I use Minecraft to practice hacking, learn about new technologies, and accumulate more computer science knowledge. Yes, I could have just not played Minecraft in the first place and just, I don't know, buy a shitty Udemy course and watch 10 hours of useless screen recording, or I spend 100 hours playing Minecraft, hacking Minecraft, and having an effing blast while doing it. And that's the whole point. Let's just have fun. And I hope I can make a fun video series for you that on the surface seems to be a standard Minecraft Let's Play, but below the surface, when we dig deeper, this is just another hacking tutorial. So give the series a chance. As I said, I just wanted to have some fun. I'm a creative person, so I like to try out new stuff. Minecraft video making with replay mod and storytelling is fun to me. And if you don't like it, don't worry, the channel is not transforming into a Let's Play channel, but if you keep watching, welcome. This is basically Pwn Adventure Season 2, just in Minecraft. So let's get going. I continued working on my little farm, breeding animals, planting trees, but I only wanted to set up a bare minimum base. I really want to go exploring and collect seeds and other useful items from other biomes far away, because then I can grow stuff here at home. I emptied my inventory and started heading into the direction of the savannah village I saw down from the mountain. On the way, I also found some sugarcane, and of course I looked through all the houses and see what I can take. Melon seeds, nice. Ooh, you have a brewing stand? No, it's my brewing stand. I decided to leave the village behind for now to continue my journey, and I came across this little cave with dripstone, which is awesome. They can be used to generate infinite lava, and that is very useful to have in a base. Really happy that I found this. After that, I stumbled into a little desert and got some cactus. In the distance, I also saw jungle trees, so I really want to head there. And just before we got there, I ran into a broken nether portal. Awesome! Some really nice gold and other loot from the chests, amazing. But when I reached the jungle, I realized I didn't bring shears. I want shears so I can cut down the vine from the tree, and I didn't bring or find any iron. So I decided to head to a close by mountain to find some iron ore and smelt it. I saw some and was really surprised by the weird cobblestone here. I decided to break it and oh my god, here's a zombie spawner. Crazy. Let's remember this place, maybe we can build a basic XP farm here. Anyway, I built my way up to the iron and finally I could smelt some ingots. Get my shears and I could cut down the vines. In the jungle I also got some bamboo, which is awesome, and I found this beautiful forest fire. Great place for a selfie. Cheese. While I'm having a good time in Minecraft, exploring, gathering, crafting, I started to wonder, how does Minecraft even work? You know, a while ago I developed my own multiplayer game in Unity for the Cybersecurity Germany. In this game, the students had to hack it. I had no game development experience before that, and of course also no multiplayer game development experience, but of course over the years you see a few things here and there, and for example, I have looked at the network protocol from the hackable Pwn Adventure game. In that series, we even developed a TCP proxy to man in the middle the whole traffic and decode the packets. We could even use it to inject our own packets into it. So in the case of Pwn Adventure and also my own game, to implement walking around, each player simply sends their position update packets to the server. The packet just contains the X, Y, and Z coordinates of the player. Nothing special. And of course, when you can manipulate the coordinates in the packet, we were able to teleport or even fly around. But how does Minecraft do it? Let's find out. Before we start hacking around, I wanted to say that we can do our research without affecting other players. This is very important to me. Minecraft is a game where everybody can create their own adventure. That's what's so beautiful about it. And even more, you can do that together with friends. But when you start cheating around other people, for example in PvP, then you cross a line. Your choice of how you want to play is negatively affecting other people's experience. And I don't want to do that. I want to play the game how I want to, with cheating, but I only cheat to dig deeper and learn more. And so I just do that on my own personal server without affecting anybody. And you should do that too. We are here to learn hacking and we are not here to be assholes. So have fun exploring Minecraft with me, but do it in a responsible and respectful way. Anyway, time to set up our own local server for testing. I've heard Paper is a typical go-to server nowadays, no clue. Also, by the way, if it wasn't clear by now, I'm focusing on Minecraft Java Edition, not Bedrock. Okay, so I clone the Paper repository and run the two Gradle commands, apply patches and create jar. Now, we just take the jar when it's built and run the server with java minus jar. This will fail, but it created some files. We have to accept the Mojang license agreement now. The EULA is important, and next video, when we look more closely at Minecraft servers, it's important that we read and understand the EULA. No joke. We can also modify the server properties now, change the game mode and so forth. I disable online mode so I can connect with multiple clients to it without having to worry about accounts. Cool. Now we have a local server that we can connect to with our Minecraft client. So how do we learn about the protocol now? There's this amazing wiki.vg site which documents the Minecraft protocol. Every packet is listed here. And there is a player position and look packet client bound, and a player position and rotation packet server bound. So this is sent by the server to the client to tell you the position of the players, and this is the packet you sent to the server to tell where you are. And look at that. Like Pwn Adventure or my own game, Minecraft simply sends the X, Y, and Z position of the player. In the rotation version of the packet, it also includes yaw and pitch for the viewing direction. And there is an on-ground Boolean true or false flag. Here's also a note about hacking. Check if player is moving too fast. If the total movement distance is more than 100 or 300 if the player is using an elytra, they are moving too fast. So you cannot simply teleport across the map, but maybe we can still play with it. I really want to get a network proxy set up again to play around with the packets. And after looking around for some projects, I found Quarry, which is implemented in Python. Quarry, a Minecraft protocol library. It also has some examples. There are basic clients that connect to a server. You have basic example servers that you can connect to. And you also have a proxy, a hide chat proxy. It's really easy to work with. Here you can see a method that handles downstream chat message packets, and depending on if quiet mode is turned on or not, it will throw away and ignore this packet or forward it to the client. Anyway, we can take this example, rip out the code we don't need, add a handler for all the unhandled packets, and we have a very basic proxy logger. In this case, I have the Paper server configured to not listen on the default port, but listen on port 12345, because our proxy will now listen on the default Minecraft port 25565. With -q, we can tell the Quarry proxy the port of our actual Minecraft server. This is called the upstream server, and then our client will be the downstream client. Anyway, we are waiting for a client to connect now. Let's do exactly that. This is where the proxy is running, so join the server. And immediately we can see tons and tons of packets flying. Let's go back to the start and learn more about how the protocol starts. The first packet we see is join game, sent from the server in the downstream direction to the client. As can be seen in the wiki, this packet contains a lot of information, like telling you your entity ID, the game mode of the server, the viewing distance, and so forth. But actually, this is not really the first packet. In the protocol FAQ, we find more information. Minecraft actually has encrypted traffic, and our proxy handles that already, so it only shows us the packets after the client fully connected to the server and we see the regular game protocol packets. In reality, the client initiated a handshake with the server and sent login start, which sends you a Minecraft player name, after which the server responds with an encryption request, sending you the server public key. Then you send the server a secret but encrypted with the server key, as well as your verification token. Anyway, after that the client and server know the shared secret, and from now on they encrypt every data they send with AES. But Quarry takes care of all of this for us. So when we connect to Quarry, it gives us a shared secret. And so every packet we send, Quarry can easily decrypt it and we can handle it in our code. And when we dealt with it, it basically repackages the packet and sends it to the real Minecraft server. Awesome. Now we have a packet logger, and as you can see, we see so many packets. A lot of them sent from the server to our client. Every movement of animals or generally entities has to be sent to our client. So there's a lot here. That's why I decided to modify the logger and only print packets we as a client send. And there we go. When we stand still, we only get a new position update once a second or so. But when we walk around and move the camera, we see a mix of player position and look packets. Cool. So let's look more closely at the position packet. Here I add an upstream handler for the player position packet. By the way, the function name is dynamically created. It always has the format packet upstream or downstream, so the direction from client to server or server to client, and the packet name. All of these packets and their expected directions can be found in this CSV file, which is documented for each Minecraft version. So here we have player position defined as upstream in the latest version, so we can use here a packet handler to handle it. Quarry actually has some features to unpack and parse the packet to get the position, but we can do it ourselves by hand. With buff read, we get the raw bytes of the packet. And looking at the wiki, we can see what the binary data means. We have three doubles followed by a byte. So we can use the Python struct module to extract exactly those values from the raw byte string, and we get the values in x, y, and z and ground. Then we can print it. To forward the packet to the actual server, we have to call upstream send packet. We want to send a player position packet and pass in the raw bytes again. And when we now run the proxy, we can see that we get the position information from the player. Awesome. And now let's play with this. What happens when we modify those values? Can we teleport around? Maybe fly? How about we just add a constant value of 5 to the y coordinate? Our client doesn't know this is happening. The client thinks we are standing on the ground, but because the packet goes through our proxy and there it adds 5 to it, the server thinks the player is at plus 5 in the air. And so other players would see that as well, as flying. So let's try it. As you saw, I modified the proxy to always add plus 5 to the player position. And now see here the two perspectives. Left is the ego perspective of the player who simply stands on the ground, but other players and the server obviously see the modified position with y plus 5. We are flying. Oh, flying detected. I mean, it kind of worked for like 2 seconds, but the server did detect that we were flying and kicked us. Okay, let's maybe not continuously modify the value, but just send a single teleport packet. I wrote this teleport proxy class and I took inspiration from the quarry chat example. When the client sends a chat message packet with the text slash port and a number for the teleport distance, we do some maths on the last known position and look direction of the player so we can manipulate the position forward by exactly that distance. And then we could send the new manipulated position to the server.
But if I would do that, the client doesn't know we teleported and we just sent the old position packet and basically port back. So instead, I sent the player position and look packet to the client, acting as a server and tell the client, hey, by the way, your position is now this. And after that, the client sends the new manipulated positions to the server. Let's try it. Can we teleport with that? Slash port and a number, the distance.
And it works, at least for reasonable small numbers. It was clear that we couldn't teleport very far with the speed restrictions. We can also port straight up. That's pretty cool. So I wanted to do another test. Can we use that to teleport through walls? I quickly set up a tinted glass wall. Of course, this is all survival and it took me ages to find the amethyst geodes, I swear. Anyway, when I try to teleport through the wall, it doesn't work. But when I was testing a bit more and added a roof, I realized I can teleport up. We can teleport through roofs. I don't know why yet, but I take it. Now we have a very good first impression how the protocol works, and we found an amazing resource, this wiki, which documents everything. Kudos to all the contributors of that wiki, thanks so much for your efforts, and of course thanks to the quarry contributors as well. Let's see where our Minecraft journey takes us next episode.